So natural language processing is anytime a computer is doing operations basically with text data, with language data. That could be understanding language. It could be reading words in an email and trying to make a decision if this is a spam email or not. Audio, written text, whatever language text, all that umbrella term bubbles up into NLP. Anything about those?
So kind of said differently, it brings together the computer program with this idea of linguistics. So in essence, it's basically Rob's brain times trillions, right?
You're listening to All Things Content from Avenue CX, delivering you cutting-edge insights into the past, present, and future of all topics related to content. Here's your host, Kevin Nichols.
Hello, and welcome to All Things Content. I am your host, Kevin P. Nichols of All Things Content, where we discuss everything and anything related to content, and then some. Today, we are going to be discussing artificial intelligence and more specifically, generative AI. We're going to break down some definitions. We're going to give you some use cases for it from a real company, and we're going to make it more real for what it is and what it is not for those of us for whom are encountering more and more of it, which would pretty much be probably everybody listening to the show. I have as my guest Megan Gihooly and Rob Sylvester. Both hail from a company called Reltio. Reltio is an AI-powered data unification and management capabilities company, a master data management company, which essentially takes disparate data and unifies it to make it more meaningful for those with a vested interest in analytics, as well as a vested interest in data. And I'll let both of you speak a little bit more to that in one moment. I have known Megan for several years. She has worked in content and content strategy at an enterprise content strategy level for a variety of different companies, including Amazon and Zoom, before she started working with Reltio. She's a thought leader on many topics, and she has touched content at every level of the customer lifecycle, from support to product to new customer acquisition. She's very much an expert in all things content strategy, and I'm delighted to have her here. I am new to Rob Sylvester. This is the first time that he and I are meeting. He is an ML engineer for Reltio, and in a minute, I want him to explain to us what a machine learning engineer is, because not everybody is going to have knowledge of what that capability is on our show. Rob, you've got years and years of experience as an engineer, but what stuck out to me in your bio as a content person was, in addition to engineering, you have a degree in Italian. And you actually wrote an graduate level thesis on the influence of cinematic Italian neorealism throughout the history of international film, which is fascinating to us. We have covered film on more than one show, and we may have to get you back to discuss that. So, Rob, I'm going to turn it over to you to let me know if there's anything I missed there. You can speak a little bit about the Italian background, too, but also please let us know what a machine learning engineer is.
Sure. Thanks for the introduction, Kevin. Yeah. So my background, you know, well before the world of machine learning blew up and everybody and their dog started talking about ChatGPT and all this powered AI, the old school way of doing this used to be studying linguistics, and you had to study, have like formal backgrounds in some of the nitty gritty details of linguistics. And for me, a lot of that was linguistics and foreign languages. So I had that discipline married with a computer science discipline. So these things traditionally used to be a bit more separate, and nowadays they're becoming one. And the modern day engineer, the modern day machine learning engineer, essentially what that means is that's a traditional software engineer. That's the guy that goes out there and writes code and or builds web pages and tests code and all the things that a normal software engineer does, but with this additional skill set. And this additional skill set is primarily centered around building models with machines, statistical models, a little bit of mathematics knowledge, but it's mostly just this additional skill set that usually requires a graduate degree, but not always, in learning how to build machine learning models. So think of it as just like a software engineer with just this additional training.
Gotcha. And are we going to see more ML engineers proliferating in industries as generative AI and these types of technologies and these types of solutions start to proliferate more? Do you think we'll see more of your role?
Absolutely. So we like to say, a lot of people that study computer science we like to say that we have to just keep re-earning that degree through our lives, because so many new technologies come out and things change. And if you don't stay up to date, you just get phased out. Well, one thing that's happening now is that it's becoming very clear that the software engineer without any machine learning background, or at least without some basics of how to do machine learning or use some of these machine learning tools, that will soon be a position that gets phased out. So I would say that those two are merging together very quickly.
Interesting. And Megan, we're going to get to you in 1 second, but I did want to follow up with a question about the linguistics background. So kind of what I'm hearing here is that, you know, that generative AI and the natural, well, we'll get more into definitions in a minute, but the way with which to think about this is that it really is teaching machine to learn language to a certain degree. And because of that, is that where the linguistics background comes into play? Or could you just speak a little bit more about that? Because I think it's fascinating.
Sure, sure. So the linguistics background and the way that when you teach a machine to deal with text data, it's a very difficult problem because, and there are many solutions to it, but ultimately a computer has to represent things with numbers, right? So if you are dealing with text data, it's not so straightforward how to do that. And traditionally, there were many, many approaches that leaned on linguistic knowledge, you know, dating all the way back to like Noam Chomsky's linguistics fundamentals from the 1950s that would guide us in representing that text in a machine. Nowadays, we have far more sophisticated methods that are more on the spectrum of pure machine learning and less domain knowledge in linguistics. And that's what most of the stuff you hear about today is. So it's not to say that it's useless, all that stuff that I studied, but I guarantee you, if you went to school for it again, a lot of it would be taught very differently.
Right. Because it's advanced so much too.
Yeah. A lot.
And our understanding, I think, of it as advanced. Megan, I want to give you a second. Did I capture your role and Reltio correctly? Is there anything else you would like to say about that I didn't?
I think you captured it perfectly. I do want to say that I didn't work for Zoom. I worked for Zoomin. So that's a very
big,
good clarification. Zoom would be more mad, or Zoom would be mad about that. But I just wanted to point that out. But other than that, yeah, you definitely captured the majority of it. I have really expanded beyond just content, and I focus a lot on self-help as well as user experience. And so I have both the docs team and the UX team rolling up to me, which is really a cool synergy that works very, very well. As we're building out doc portals, we have the user experience team there to sort of assist. As we're building out self-help models, we look at the docs team to check the writing while the UX team looks at the user experience.
Yeah, and when I talk about folks such as yourself, and I kind of lump myself in that to a certain degree, I talk about us as experts within the customer content experience and all aspects of that. Because you and I have had conversations about personalization. We've had conversations about AI. We've had around self-service customer support content. So you can touch on all of these, and you have a vested experience in all of them. Sorry, Zoomin. One's a CMS and one's web share platform. I know the difference, and I've actually worked with Zoomin, so apologies for that. Sometimes I speak faster than I think, or whatever, that, vice versa, I'm not sure. Let's get started. So I want to dive right into some definitions, and I think definitions are a good way for us to all align, as well as get our audience a little bit more information about what this stuff means, because there is a lot of mystique surrounding it. I will note this, that I attended the 2024 Forrester Predictions for Technology and Customer Experience in late January, and George Colony had an interesting point. George Colony, for those of you that don't know, is the CEO of Forrester, and he incapped that conversation by saying that AI and generative AI in particular is the single most technology breakthrough of his lifetime. Now, I was like, some people might say this is a bit of a histrionic, but I actually think that there's something to what he's saying. And I think that given what its impact is about to unleash and what it's about to be, it's important that our audience start getting an understanding about its what it actually is, as opposed to sort of the hype that we hear or the mythology we hear around it or the mystique. So let's start with some definitions. If we could just define artificial intelligence, which dates all the way back and from my understanding to Alan Turing of the late 1940s and early 50s and its inception, how would we define artificial intelligence as a starting point?
I'll take it. That one's for me.
Either one, Rob, feel free.
So I'm glad you asked this one because I like to, one thing I've noticed a lot in industry is people interchangeably use the terms artificial intelligence and machine learning. And I'm not sure if you're going to ask what the definition of machine learning is or not, but I would very much like to define these two because they are different.
Let's define both.
So artificial intelligence, that has to do with anytime we try to make a computer think like a human or represent knowledge like a human or incur some kind of bias that we want it to behave in some human-like way by creating an intelligence of whatever kind, that's artificial intelligence. When you play against your old Windows 95 computer and play like blackjack, that's an AI that you're playing against. And even if it's just playing simple little rules of, you know, oh, don't hit if it's above 17 or something like that, that's still an AI, right? Mm-hmm. So that is a much broader term. Machine learning, which is almost everything that you're hearing about nowadays that's coming out. Machine learning, those are models that computers build upon by learning about data. They make decisions given data, and this is my favorite definition of machine learning, which is that machines are given a certain amount of data, they make a decision, and then with more data, they make a better decision. So machine learning is a tool that is part of AI, right? Think of AI as like the whole toolbox. Machine learning is just one of those tools. So all of these fancy models that are coming out, these ChatGPTs and these image generators, these are all machine learning models. They're still AI models, right? Because machine learning is a subset of artificial intelligence, but it doesn't go the other way around. So keep that in mind if you're using these terms interchangeably, right? Which one is which?
Yeah, that's a really good point. And I'm glad that you clarify that. And the other one that gets thrown on a lot when people are talking about AI, which they seem to mean as a subset of AI, but I think it's more of an aspect of it, which is generative AI, which in its most common form seems to me to be the definition would be like the ability to generate content or text or images by using machine learning. But how would you define that, Rob?
So there's two major kinds of machine learning models out there. Mm-hmm. And one is a generative model and one is a discriminatory model. And the difference is, like, if I were to give you a credit card transaction and then say, okay, Bank of America, use your machine learning model and tell me if this is a fraudulent transaction or a legitimate one. Then it is discriminating. That's what that model is doing. It's making a decision saying yes or no, right? And that's what most machine learning models traditionally have been in industry and even in content. A generative model is different. A generative model, what it's doing is it's producing, in almost every case, it's actually producing a distribution, right? So let's think of what that means in the context of, if we're writing content with a generative AI, what we're generating is a word. We're generating a word at a time. And we're looking at a model that's saying, okay, here's all the words in the English language, and we are going to generate a distribution or a probability of every single word. And then we're just going to pick the best one. And then we're going to do that over and over and over and over again. So these generative models, they could be generating pixels in an image. They could be generating words from a language like English or from Russian. They could be generating characters, not necessarily words, like one character at a time from the alphabet. But whatever it is, they repeat this process over and over again of generating as opposed to making a selection.
Got it. I think that's really good. Another thing that we see a lot of, and they had this, for example, in the Forrester, but if basically if you read any of the analysts out there, they're all talking about AI right now. And then they're breaking it down into the general concepts that you need to know about. Some of them do it better than others. I'd still love a diagram or a visualization that is able to capture all the key concepts and their interrelationships, but I've yet to see that. But the next thing that we go to in a lot of these discussions, and I'm going to skip some of the more technical stuff like the transformers and all that, but the next thing that we go to are like large language models and the natural language processing. So how would you then... So we've discussed generative, we've discussed discriminatory. Where did what they call natural language processing, NLP, and large language models, LLMs is an abbreviation you'll all see a lot of. Where do these fit into the picture?
Sure. So natural language processing is anytime a computer is doing operations basically with text data, with language data that could be understanding language. It could be reading words in an email and trying to make a decision if this is a spam email or not. It could be listening to our text conversation right now and turning that into, you know, taking the audio spectrogram and turning that into text. All of that stuff is NLP. Anything that has to do with our natural language, whether it's audio, written text, whatever language text, all that umbrella term bubbles up into NLP. Anything about those computational linguistics is another way of saying it.
So kind of said differently, it brings together the computer program with this idea of linguistics. So in essence, it's basically Rob's brain times trillions, right? Trillions right. of Rob's brains out there understanding language.
And that gets us into large language models then, right?
Sure. Yeah. LLMs. So that's something. LLMs have been around for a little bit longer than maybe the media might suggest based on the hype train, right? But a large language model, fundamentally, all it is just a model that tries to learn which words appear around other words. And that sounds, you know, that sounds a little abstract, right? Mm-hmm. But and it does go back to even, like I said, these models from the 1950s or the 1960s. Large language models are trained to try to look at words and guess what the next word might be. I went to the store and I bought a carton of blank, right? And the large language model might say, okay, eggs. Well, another, or maybe it might say milk, right? Both of those would be good guesses. But the word... you know, potato probably would not be a very good guess. So large language models are models that are built to try to understand essentially which words appear in similar contexts of other words. Right. And before that, you know, one thing that I it's not such an abstract idea because really in general, I like to think of language itself as pretty much that anyway. That's all we do as humans. As well. We only define words in the context of other words anyway. So it's a very similar abstraction to what we do without thinking about it.
Right. And context is key. It's kind of like if you study an ancient language without that doesn't have vowels, you know, or diacritical marks, you have to infer what that word is based on its context, right? So the more knowledge you have of that language, that culture or whatever, the more you're able to ascertain what is being written or what is being said.
Yeah.
Especially when you have a consonants that could, depending on the vowel, create all different types of words, and you just have like four consonants. But if you were to add vowels to it that you don't have access to, it could be like 10 different variations, right, of the word, which does happen, by the way. So I want to go into the last definition because I think it kind of brings it all together. Deep learning. When we think of deep learning, what is that vis-a-vis generative AI and AI?
Sure.
And all of this stuff, and how does that encapsulate kind of what it is that we're talking about here?
So in that big umbrella, if we think of AI as like the big all-encompassing definition, and we think of machine learning as a smaller subset, a tool within AI, deep learning is a tool within machine learning. It's a particular kind of machine learning. And what it means is it's a machine learning model or set of models that are built using deep neural networks, big neural networks. And that's a kind of, it's the kind of machine learning model that that is used to power just about, not everything, but just about any machine learning model built today is built with a deep neural network. A large language model is a deep neural network. You talked about, you know, any of these transformers, those are all deep neural networks. Almost every NLP model that's built today, deep neural network. So you're seeing these ones get interchanged a lot now, deep learning with machine learning, with AI, but it's mostly because everything's a deep learning model nowadays. So we just use all these terms interchangeably, but that formally is the difference.
Well, let's talk about some real use cases for it, because I think that'll help crystallize some of these concepts a little bit. So Megan, I want to turn to you. Mm-hmm. We know that AI has impacted Reltio, and it has done it in a lot of ways. In fact, your product, or basically your company's value proposition, is marketed off of an AI premise. So how has it impacted Reltio, and how do you plan on using it?
Yeah, there's so many ways that we plan on using it. Right now, we do a number of different things, but I'll kind of talk you through what we've done in the last 6 months that really pertains specifically to me. And then there's some stuff that Rob actually built that is super cool that I probably won't do service to. So I'll let him describe that stuff. So about May of last year, I had a number of people coming to me all excited to use generative AI to start servicing the customers by looking through the doc portal. And after about the fifth time I got that request, I brought a whole group of people together and said, guys, okay, let's talk. Let's figure out what we're working on. Let's try and do this in a unified way. This isn't Amazon where you can do the same thing three times and see who wins. We're not that big of a company. We need to be efficient about it, and we want to be fast, and we want to do it the best way. So let's come together and do that. So that group of people got together and we started to talk about how could we use the documentation portal specifically, and then eventually our knowledge base and community and other things to really drive a better customer experience and to help support our customers better. And so that led to me writing a PRFAQ, which is something we used to do at Amazon all the time, brought that PRFAQ to the product offsite, went through it with the product management. That then led to this sort of innovation that we now call RIA, Reltio Intelligent Assistant. And so RIA then went on, once we had a hackathon and a bunch of skills were brought in through the hackathon, I then went through all those hackathons and added all of the skills we think RIA should do. And so that was sort of how RIA became born. RIA is now out there in the world. All it does today is it looks through the documentation portal and gives answers. We actually have a documentation portal version of it. We have an in-product version of it. The in-product version of it will do so, so, so much more, right? It will actually look through the tenant and bring back the appropriate data based on a query. So some of that is the stuff that Rob is working on, and he'll speak too much more intelligently. But from a content standpoint, I think we've done a lot of learning about what works, what doesn't work, how to do it well, how do you sort of set the temperature right, how creative you want it to be. So there's just a ton of learnings we've done from a content standpoint to really get this thing running.
So Rob, let's dovetail that a little bit. What did you do specifically with Reltio, and what types of solutions have you seen as an output of that?
Sure. So if you think of, Reltio and most content companies, there's two kinds of data that we have. You have text data and you have image data for the most part. Text data is all the talk of the town. And that's what we hope to be able to do with RIA and some of these other models that we've built. So what do people do with text data? Well, they search text data. They try to filter text data. Sometimes they try to summarize or they try to compress text data, right? Those are all the things that a human generally tries to do when we're looking through content. Well, those are basically the same abstractions that we're trying to do in an automated fashion through some of these deep learning models, right? We are trying to, in the case that Megan's talking about, what you're looking at, if you search through content of knowledge bases, if you search through Reltio documentation, if you search through FAQs, you can do that as a human, and you can literally search through it, and you can look for keywords, and you can try to you know, peruse it through all the ways that that humans do that, or you can try to build an AI model, a machine learning model, a deep learning model that takes in some query that somebody writes in, hey, how do I write this API at Reltio? And have that model analyze your query and then go and look through all of that content and pick out the pieces that are relevant to that query. And once it picks out those pieces that are relevant, it returns them back to you. And when it returns them back to you, in a very naive way, it can, you know, verbatim print these exact pieces of content back to you, or it can do something fancier, like summarize them, provide different representations. But usually what it is some sort of compressed summary relevant to what that user's query is. So that's the specific use case that a lot, not just myself, in fact, there's other teams at Reltio that lead a lot of this work and have done a lot of it and done it very well. But that's mostly what that use case is.
And my understanding is that it can also refine that search query should it need to be refined with much more accuracy than, say, like if I don't get the search results I need, right? Mm-hmm. I may or may not know how to use Boolean or other types of logic to build into that search query to sort of hone down what it is that I want. Or there may or may not be technology built in for relevance, like technology that is looking at my previous existing products or my previous searches or ways to personalize it to make it more relevant to me. But my understanding is that with this, it kind of does all of that. Like it can look at not only has it given you the results that you need, but if you need to refine those results, making it much more specific to the relevance of what it is that you're looking for. And therefore the results are going to be much more accurate more frequently than say, and it learns over time. Like, so it's learning over time how to even make that even more relevant or accurate as time goes on, as it has more data to process about what's going to mean relevance or what's going to mean accuracy for that end user. Am I correct there?
Yeah. Yeah, you are correct. The difference about this kind of an interface or this kind of a tool is that it really is a conversational agent. And a conversational agent, as opposed to, okay, ask question, get response, and then next question has like no knowledge whatsoever of what you just said. You know, there's a very big difference between that and what you're talking about, which is refinement. And with Rhea and with a lot of these modern AI tools, the aim is to be able to refine that search query in that iterative fashion, to be able to say, okay, how do I do this? And then and then you get a response. You say, okay, no, that's not exactly what I mean. I was looking for more, blah, blah, blah. But when you put in that second search query, to be able to still be aware of the initial context of your previous conversation, which is a fundamentally very different way of interacting with content or interacting with even a model or an API or queries and databases. That's a very different way of doing that interaction.
Right. Yeah, it is. It's very different and much more sophisticated. I want to ask, so you have this Rhea, you have Rhea.
Yeah.
Rhea, where did you start? Like, how do you even know where to start with something like this? If you want to roll out, let's say, some type of AI capability in your organization, you want it to be end user facing, you want it to be something that can be generative. How do you know where to start regarding content?
Yeah. That's kind of where we were last May, right? When I brought this group of people together, because everyone wanted to just run. Okay, let's just do this. But we needed to think about what were we hoping to get out of it? What are the actual metrics we want? What is the purpose of it? Is it to reduce support cases? Is it to create a great user experience? Is it to somehow lead to sales, right? Like, what are you using this AI for is very, very important. Bring the right people to the table. You have to have people like Rob who can talk the technical talk and then You need other people that are more like me, where we understand sort of the user flows and can think through how an end user might come at it without necessarily understanding all of the technical background. And so when you talk through it, you'll come up with a purpose for your AI, right? And then my suggestion, and I'm sure Rob would agree, is keep it slim at first. Don't try and boil the ocean. Find one use case. So for us, we wanted to make sure, we work in the data world, right? So security is huge for us. So we weren't going to go start with some content that's locked down and not public, right? Because there's a whole security layer there and a whole authentication layer there that is just adds complexity. So we started with our doc portal, which is 100% open, has a ton of content, right? 7,000 pages, I think, of content, and really answers questions that customers have. So it was the natural starting point. So for us, it was all about, let's get that right first before we start bringing in knowledge articles and community and learning, which, you know, you have to log in to get to. Keeping this sort of thin slice was important. The next thing we didn't want to use a model that would put our company at risk in any way, including bringing in information that was irrelevant, bringing in information that maybe was from competitors, or giving just flat out wrong answers, right? We wanted to get it as right as possible. We understand that it's not going to get 100% right off the bat, but we wanted to control that corpus of content that we started with. And so I think those are some of the keys that we set out with. And Rob, can you think of other things we did in the initial month or so that we were meeting?
I would say that, you know, I think you summarized it well what we did. To answer, you know, the big one that I would add in to answer Kevin's question too is, you know, it maybe this is just a piece of advice for content developers out there who are looking at what are these AI tools, what can we have them bring? Remember, like Megan said, to always start with trying to solve a customer problem. Try to start with something simple that you're trying to do. Don't start with the tool itself and try to find a way to fit it in just because that's what the hype train is, mm-hmm. right? And we call that mechanism bias. A lot of academics do. And it's very easy to say, okay, I need to get one of these LLMs out there. Everybody else got one. I need to get one out there, right? Because they can do all these cool things. Start with something simple. Start with, if you want to be able to, for instance, do what Megan and I were talking about now and search through your doc portal, then that's your use case. And build out the very simple pipeline and get everything working, all that boilerplate, that's all still there, right? What you don't want to end up doing is, and you're going to see this, is try to fit these things into your company when they don't have a defined use case, because what you end up with is something similar to like a dot-com boom where you have a bunch of internet companies that are just building stuff for the sake of building it without a clear vision.
Right. Boats.com, we're going to order a boat over the internet, right? Like, right. Things like this. Without thinking through this is back in 2000 or whenever, when that capability and supply chain didn't really exist to support such a thing. I wanted to ask a little bit about this because I think it's a point that I see coming up again and again. And Megan, you're starting from a content solution in your own company. And I've seen Reltio's content. Like, I've seen your support center, your knowledge base. It is very clean. It is very well structured. I mean, compared to a lot of companies, yeah. It is the document types are well defined. There's a structure to them. I'm sure that you do content audits to have relevant content out there. You don't have a lot of what we call raw, redundant, outdated, trivial content. A lot of big companies that I work with, and I work with large scale global brands, aren't starting from that point. So they're starting with content where they may have all sorts of redundancy all over the place. They may have documents that shouldn't even be out there that are out there. So one of the things that I've seen when it comes to tools that sit across the enterprise, then scrape content, and then they do sort of intelligent sort of content solutions, whether that be a customer data profile to do personalization, you know, or whether that be a federated search tool to like scrape content and then offer up search results based on all these different document repositories. it's only as good as the content that is within those systems, and only as clean as the content is within those systems. So if you have really unstructured like content that's really all over the place, it's not going to give you the output that you're looking for. Would you say the same is true with this?
Yes.
Do you want to answer or do you want me to answer? Why don't you go ahead, Megan?
I'll go ahead. So absolutely, you have to have good content. There are probably techie ways that Rob can figure out to train it not to pay attention to the bad content. But at the very base level, when you're starting, if you have really bad content, really poorly structured content, it probably will not be as successful. We were in a really good position because we had just gone through the process, not but 2 years ago, a year and a half ago at this point, of completely redoing our documentation portal, brand new taxonomy, new hierarchical structure. All of the most of the content was sort of redone and restructured before we pulled it in. Much of it was done slightly after. So we were sort of starting ahead from that. But I think you bring up a good point, and that is, I think this comes down to when people say, is AI going to make tech writers obsolete? The reality is AI is only as good as the content that you push into it, right? So it may make eventually documentation portals with navigational structures and hierarchies obsolete, but the content that feeds the AI still needs to be there and still needs to be good. And so it may change our jobs, but it certainly, it actually increases the need for really good writers who understand structured content and who can write in a way that's clear and crisp and to the point, so that the machines can really learn from it.
That's an excellent point. And Rob, did you have anything that you wanted to add to that?
Well, I think that summarizes it well. There is a distinction, though, at least as far as a model is concerned. You will never, let's be very clear, like incorrect content, outdated content, something like that, there's no machine learning model that's going to like magically fix that for you, right? A lot of the benefits that are coming out nowadays give you a little more flexibility on not necessarily having the structure right. That's one piece that we are, that when it comes to that search, like I was talking about, where you have that query and you go in and you comb through whatever structured documentation you have, you know, there's a little more flexibility in how good or bad that structure is and still being able to recall relevant pieces of content. So I would say that, so that piece is, it's a, you know, anytime you have structured content and it's very well structured, that'll help any human just as much as it will help any AI.
Right.
But if it's, as long as it's not really, really bad, then a lot of the modern advancements should be able to still pick out some relevant content.
Great point. What was the corpus of content that you trained your AI on? Let's go to more specifics. And you know, you mentioned knowledge
documentation portal. So we even though we have fabulous people like Rob on our team, we actually went through Google, and we used Google Dialog Flow at this point, and we created a project and indexed the doc portal. And so it really is just the public documentation portal that it's trained on. Now, beyond that, for the RIA that's inside the product, I think that Rob and team, and the ML team, are working on some ways to maybe change or tune that. But the one that exists on our documentation portal is really just directly indexing the doc portal.
You'd mentioned temperature before, and that's going to be something that's probably like, our users or our listeners, some of them are going to be like, what's temperature? Is that an industry term? Is this just something that we... So you mentioned the temperature being high versus low, and this is vis-a-vis the chatbot that you know you're building. What exactly does that mean, and why is that important as a concept for the what we're talking about here?
I'll give you the dummy version, and then Rob can give you the smart version. How's that? So to me, temperature is really all about creativity. If you set the temperature really low, then the AI is not going to write poetry. It's not going to make songs. It's not going to bring in insights combining your corpus of data with other insights from the world, right? It's not going to bring in a lot of creative stuff. If you set it really high, that's when you get an AI that can write poetry, can do the more creative stuff. The reason it's important is because the answers are important. When you're working in data, especially for our customers in healthcare or customers in the financial industry, if we're making up songs and, you know, having cheeky comments and entertaining them, but we're not giving them the answer they need on how they should operate the Reltio platform, then we're not doing our job, right? And that kind of comes back to the vision. If you are, let's say, a retail company, and you really want to have that sort of cheekiness that will get more and more people to come to your AI, then you might need more creativity. If you need really solid answers, you got to start with the creativity or the temperature low, and then and kind of bump it up a little bit. So Rob can talk about how we find that right level and what that means.
And I was going to say, even with retail, though, you've got to be on brand and really on brand, and it has to be constrained and constricted in certain ways that it doesn't create just a lack of that it's chaos, or that the brand is cannibalized.
Yeah. Yeah. Although sometimes brands, like, you can teach an AI your brand guidelines and your style guide, right? So that part of it's less of a concern than if it starts making stuff up, it starts hallucinating, it starts giving answers that are relevant to your competitors, things like that.
So I think everything you summarize it very well, Megan. I think it's important to remember that, you know, the reason we have something like temperature or these little control knobs with these models that we expose to developers is because we want to give them access to a trade-off. Because there's a decision there, there's a trade-off that we say for certain people in certain use cases, this knob might be turned high, and for some of them, it might be turned low. And the biggest one of these knobs, probably, for these large language models, for these generative models, is that temperature. And with respect to this definition of a generative model, a low temperature means that we are generating the same thing every time. We want to be able to, on that spectrum of the trade-off, we want to get as close to low risk wackiness and very, very disciplined responses where we just take, you know, the most probable word, carton of eggs. Okay, eggs, we're going to say eggs every time, right? Those would be the low temperatures. And high temperatures, which, you know, if you're writing poetry, like you said, maybe you want that creativity and you want more freedom and flexibility, traded off against, of course, the idea of really weird stuff coming out, right? So think of temperature is very much a control knob.
Creativity, right? So predictable on one end, creative on the other.
Yeah, predictable. The ML guys will say deterministic is a word that gets thrown around a lot, but really all that means is the same thing is coming out every time. I write the same prompt, I get the same response.
Versus very creative or...
Yeah. So if I say, like, write me a limerick about, you know, Kevin Nichols content podcast, and I set the temperature really, really low, then I would expect the same limerick to come out, or it's close to the same limerick. And if I set it really high, then I would expect, you know, two different, very different limericks to come out.
One only can imagine. That's great.
I just want to add sort of the so what to this for content folks in particular. Mm-hmm. When you think about, okay, you want to give predictable answers if you're in the data industry, right? The healthcare industry, the financial industry. You want predictable answers. You want deterministic answers, right? At the same time, when you think about the cost of AI, the cost of AI comes from how much people use it. If you end up being used the way ChatGPT is being used, your cost is going to go through the roof, right? So you also need to think about, are you trying to drive eyeballs? Because if you are, then you might want to have it be a little more cheeky and differentiated and give different answers. If you don't necessarily want to drive more eyeballs, you just want the right eyeballs to get the answers they want, that can help you set the temperature where you want to.
Yeah, that's great. And it does align with sort of the cautionary notes that I've heard from all the analysts out there. I mean, it's going to be a very turbulent time in the next couple of years. There's going to be businesses that are pushing the envelope. There's going to be businesses that don't really know what they're doing, that just dive head on in. There's going to be businesses that are more measured, that are more strategic like yours, that are going to get it right, or at least be able to get it to where you can learn from it to take it to the next level where it's not going to like adversely affect your business, you know, where that's not going to be the case for everyone. And we know that. Speaking of, what are some of the pitfalls that folks need to know about that you think they need to avoid vis-a-vis all this?
So
go ahead.
Do you want me to take it first, Megan?
Go ahead.
So outside of what we had just talked about, and that still is the first one, the very first one, which as a business, as a content creator, start with a vision and a customer problem that you're trying to solve. Do not start with, I'm just going to find a way to incorporate an LLM into my product, whatever the hell it is. That's the first pitfall. Mm-hmm. That really is. Mm-hmm. Once you get into the specifics of the actual use case, here's one that I think is very important, the next most important one, which is, Megan had mentioned the word hallucinations. That's a fun one. That's a key word that you hear about and you're saying, LLM, the hallucination. What does that mean? Well, these models, the way they work, because they are generative models, because they're not really restricted, right? They have languages that they generate text in, but that's about the only restriction, right? You can never fully eliminate the possibility that your generative model will generate something that you don't like, whether that's something toxic, whether it's, you know, hate speech. I mean, these things are trained on the internet after all, right? And you will never, ever, ever, ever be able to 100% safeguard that, right? Mm-hmm. And there have been many AI heads across all the major companies that have touted this exact same message. And it's a very important one. And so the pitfall to understand if you're an organization or you're trying to make this discussion of like, how do we have one of these LLMs or one of these generative models in our product or in our content space and have 100% safeguard on it, you'll never get it.
Right.
Right. You can put in as many guardrails as you want and you can probably get to like 99.9% safety, but it's the exact same discussion of saying, okay, if I wanted zero chance of ever getting a computer virus ever on this super, super important, you know, banking machine, then I'd have to unplug it from the internet. Mm-hmm. Right. And mm-hmm. it may be a conversation that we understand a lot in, you know, the three of us sitting here talking about it, but this is a very difficult conversation to have with like security in a large organization to open up this idea of this pitfall where you don't get 100% guarantees on something.
Yeah.
Great. I think that is the next biggest pitfall there.
That is a huge one, and it relates to a smaller but very practical version of that, which is when you put it out there, you're putting it out there to a group of solution consultants or support engineers that want the right answer. So even though they know logically that this is an AI and it's not always going to give the right answer, they're going to come back and say, I wanted to say this, I wanted to say that, I wanted to say, and you'll get that over and over and over again. So I guess the pitfall here is to not be prepared for this onslaught of feedback you're going to get. You need to understand when you get that feedback, it's important feedback. Mm-hmm. How are you going to deal with it, right? Mm-hmm. You need smart people like Rob to deal mm-hmm. with it on the technical end. You need the content team to be ready to restructure content or move content around or change words in content in order to eliminate some of it. So you have to have a way to handle this massive amount of feedback internally that you're going to get. And I imagine once you get it out to customers, it will be equally the same. So it's sort of a change management problem, but it's very much related to what Rob was just saying.
But it's also, and I say this with any type of new technology being rolled out into an organization, you need the know-how and the capacity to support that internally. So I don't recommend people just outsource this and allow some consulting firm to come in and manage that for them. I think internally you need the capability to understand the technology, which means you need like a Rob and a Megan on staff so that you can mitigate some of these risks, but also evolve that and scale that solution. And I think a lot of companies don't always account for the people element and what that's going to mean in terms of resourcing and what that's going to mean for the right skill sets to support these types of things.
Yeah, I agree. Yeah. Most people say, oh, AI, I can fire this particular team, right?
Or but I can hire this done from hire a consulting firm. Yeah. Yeah, or an independent firm can come in and implement this for me and we have the, you know what I mean? Like,
yeah.
They don't think through it.
Don't. And they do. And it introduces another major pitfall for organizations, which is this. You're going to see, and this is one that I like a powerful message that I would love to emphasize. If you're thinking about trying to build one of these models and you see in your organization and you see thousands of these advertisements on LinkedIn and all over the internet saying, okay, we're like this one click solution to being able to provide LLMs that can answer questions about all this information and summarize things well and solve all your problems, they can't, right? What they can do is they can do that in like a quick POC, cherry-picked examples where those things work. Ask yourself what's going to happen when that breaks down or when it works 77% of the time. And the other 23% of the time, your customers come back and say, this messed up. And if you don't have the staffing and you don't have a few people that are experts in being able to go under the hood and actually figure out how these things work and fix them, then be prepared to have something that only works 77% of the time and you're stuck at that roadblock in not being able to advance it further.
It's a great point. It's an excellent point. And we do see that happening, by the way, more. Yeah. I mean, it happens. It's the silver bullet solution that everybody promises whenever we have new technology coming out. You know,
exactly.
Yeah.
That sort of plug and play sort of approach, which this is obviously not going to be, it's not going to work with this. Anything that we didn't touch on that you'd like to touch on in the few minutes we have left, and then I'll end cap it with the final question.
I think we covered the basis of most of this stuff well. The pitfalls question, as far as an organization is concerned, that like that's the big one to me.
Yeah.
As far as content creators are there, like just make sure that, you know, if you're trying these modern solutions of these, you're going to hear about these vector databases, these knowledge graphs, these LLMs. Focus it down to one or two simple problems that you want to try to solve quickly. Try to get the staffing to be there and then ask yourself, like, where are the bottlenecks in your organization with content developers or with humans in the loop that you think you could automate here or you could do better? And if that's the case, if you can identify a few of those, then you have a good use case for using this technology.
Love it.
Yeah. And I would add, as a content leader, I know content leaders out there will get requests to scrape their content. Everybody is going to want to generate other content based on your content. Mm-hmm. So be the person that brings all those people together. I think that's a very important thing because if collaborate together, you can do amazing things, right? Rhea is the product of that. If you don't collaborate, everyone goes out and hacks a bunch of solutions. You're going to have a bunch of different solutions and the customer experience will be even worse than before you had any of those solutions.
Which I love, Megan, and I know you and I both talk about the importance of interoperable and collaborative multidisciplinary content teams, but it's forming that content team and bringing all those folks together to have those discussions. I love it.
Yes, exactly.
Any advice for young people trying to get into this industry? We always ask this question at the end of my show. So I ask my guests if you have any words of advice for people that are just entering into the field. And I know, Megan and Rob, you're coming at it from two different angles, but just quickly, any advice for young people?
Yeah. If you're getting into this machine learning world, remember that machine learning is just one piece of software engineering. If you want to try to build all these models and get them in production, remember that's like 5% of what it takes to actually build one of these things in a real system. good engineering practices, writing code every day, the fundamentals of what that means has not changed. So don't get caught up too much in just learning about how a transformer model works. Be a good engineer, learn good engineering practices. That's your bread and butter.
Love it. Anything else to add there, Megan?
I think from a content standpoint, it almost flips the other way, right? I feel as a very experienced content person, a number of times throughout my career, I've had to completely change. And this is one of those times where I have to pivot and almost feel like I'm just coming into this world, right? So I think people just coming in to content today might actually have a bit of a bonus. You still need to be able to learn and do all the things that you learned in your 20s where you think you can take on the world and, you know, take feedback and do all that good stuff. But I think not having to unlearn the way we did tech writing 20 years ago is actually a bonus right now. So right. Rely on that and understand that you have a point of view that is very important and is likely different than the me's of the world who have been doing this for 25, 30 years.
And you're coming in, you and I came in during the advent of the internet, which was a very unique time.
Yes.
But this is even like that, you know, this is even, I think, more of a unique time.
Right.
It's a very interesting time to get your feet wet in the career world of technology,
yes,
customer experience, content, all of these things.
Yes.
Well, thank you both so much. This has been exactly what I wanted it to be, which is a preliminary discussion on artificial intelligence, generative AI, and then practical use cases for it, as well as just sort of thinking through how that impacts business and what that kind of means. I think both of you were brilliant in terms of some of your observations and as well as the ability to talk about the impact and just ways to think through it. So I want to thank you both for being a guest on my show. Definitely, you're both welcome back at any time. And Rob, would love to discuss film at some point with you. So
anytime, man.
Thank you. And this is All Things Content. This is Kevin P. Nichols, your host. And stay tuned for our next show where we will be discussing personalization and standardization. Thank you.
That was All Things Content with Kevin Nichols. Thanks for listening. Remember to leave a like and a comment if you're watching on YouTube, a 5-star review if you're listening on Apple Podcasts, or a follow if you're listening on Spotify. You can connect with Kevin on LinkedIn or follow him on Twitter at KP Nichols. You can also connect with his company by following Avenue CX on LinkedIn, Twitter, or Facebook at Avenue CX. All Things Content with Kevin Nichols is a production of Kevin P. Nichols and Avenue CX. Thanks again for listening.